Thank you very much, Dr. Yoku. I think we've been unfortunate that both of our patients died. And I think it shows that AKI and sepsis are actually very bad twins. So I'm going to talk about the clinical approach to acute kidney injury. I didn't liaise with the author, so I left most of the management to author, and I think Dr. Quisla will deal with the management. So I'm going to talk a little about what is AKI, how we classify AKI, the causes of AKI, a bit about the clinical presentation, and because of the topic of the day, I'm going to dwell a bit on the urine and its role, as well as its prognostic factor, and then a few other diagnostic tests. I'll leave the management to Dr. Arthur. So as a way of background, acute kidney injury used to be known as renal failure. I think for most of us, when we are studying in the medical school, we used to call it renal failure. But later on, because they discovered that it was quite a spectrum, before someone got into failure, definitions changed. In around 2006, people began to question the definition of acute renal failure. But as we have already seen, acute kidney injury is really associated with the high burden of mortality. In a study done by Dr. Bagasha and most of us, it was noted that up about 16.3% of patients who had sepsis had acute kidney injury. And they screened over 16,000 patients from the casualty in Malago, and about 390 patients were included in the study. What was a major finding is that 21% of these patients died, and this study was actually done with Dr. Nakwagala and Arthur and the team, and the major problem was that these people did not have access to the ICU, so that was a major leading cause of death. In another study we did with the Kresla at IHK, for patients who had access to dialysis and ICU, the mortality was up to 52% of those who required dialysis in ICU. These people had access to dialysis, but they actually still died. And Arthur's argument was that probably if we had CRRT, continuous renal replacement therapy, maybe we could have saved more, but we actually wanted to demonstrate that even without CRRT, we can still make some difference. But once a person is required to go to ICU, then their risk of mortality actually goes up. So acute kidney injury is very important. And as we are going to see, the best way is to always think about it beforehand and not wait too long, because every minute that is lost, the prognosis becomes worse. So what is acute kidney injury? As Dr. Yoku defined, acute kidney injury is actually dysfunction of the kidney that may be associated with the elevation of retention of products of excretion, plus minus reduced urine output. But the kidney disease improving global outcomes, the KDIGO, defines acute kidney injury as a serum creatinine rise of about 26 micromoles within 48 hours. If you are using milligrams, you divide that by 88.4, or a serum creatinine rise of more than 1.5, okay, in a person who is presumed to have been normal or was stable for more than a week, or reduced urine output of less than 0.5 mils per kilogram per hour in 6 consecutive hours. So you can use any of those definitions. You see that they are not really very easy to come by, but that is the clinical definition of AKI. This came out of the fact that many people used to do definition of acute kidney injury in many ways, and so when it came to interpretation, it was quite difficult. So the Kidney Foundation actually decided to put those definitions across so that we could have interpretation across the world. And with this came the new classifications, which we have seen. One of them is called the RIFO criteria, which is actually risk, injury, failure, loss of function, and end-stage renal disease. So basically, this criteria looks at two things. You can look at the creatinine itself. If the creatinine increases by 1.5, that person is at risk. But you could also look at it by translating into the glomerular filtration rate. If the glomerular filtration rate decreases by more than 25%, then that person is at risk. Or they go into injury if the increase is 2 times or higher, or the GFR is more than 50%, and then they fail if the creatinine increase is more than 3 times, or they have a creatinine of more than 4 mg/dL. You could also use the urine output if it is less than 0.5 mils per kilogram per hour over 6 hours, or if it continues to be less for 12 hours and it is failure if it continues to be less for more than 24 hours or people are anuric for more than 12 hours. So that's the RIFO criteria, and then the loss is really when you have AR, acute renal failure continuing, or acute kidney injury continuing, and ESRD is when you need dialysis, or if your GFR really drops below 15. So the AKI criteria looked at that because it was very difficult, especially when you are talking about the percentage change of glomerular filtration rate, because in acute kidney injury, the nature of the problem is that the creatinine and renal function are always changing very fast. So if you are going to calculate the GFR, you need a steady state. And so we don't use GFR usually in acute kidney injury. So that was the critique to the RIFO criteria. The RIFO criteria, many studies demonstrated that classifying people according to the RIFO criteria was actually good, but it had that weakness, particularly when they were including the glomerular filtration rate. So we got to the Acute Kidney Injury Network, which actually just modified the RIFO criteria, and you can see that most of these things are similar, save for the fact that they are not using the GFR. So that's key, and those are the references as early as 2002. But why is this classification important? It is important because it is the level of risk, failure, injury, or risk is actually has a connotation to the outcomes. In fact, even in the study by Bagasha, they showed that patients who had RIFO criteria or RIFO criteria of injury had worse outcomes than those who are just at risk. So this grading is important and is associated with outcomes. Maybe one of the other things that we should think about as the advent of acute kidney injury is that this acute kidney injury is a process. It doesn't occur suddenly. And that's why recognizing it is very important, because we can prevent a lot of things. So usually it is a matter of time before most of these things occur. So you can see you begin out with a normal kidney, and then we have acute kidney injury, which usually lasts about 7 days. We now have a new terminology because we always had acute kidney injury within the first 7 days. Then after that, you say you go for chronic kidney disease after 90 days, which is 3 months of consistent abnormal renal function, or of consistent abnormalities of the kidney. Now in the middle there, we now have what we call acute kidney disease. So if the injury is between 7 days and 90 days, that's actually what we call acute kidney disease before we transition to the CKD. But the pathophysiology is such that you continue destroying all parts of the kidney until the kidney becomes totally destroyed and it fails with the fibrosis. This is another emphasis on the spectrum and time, as well as some of the interventions that you might want to do. But the most important thing is actually recognition. Acute kidney injury actually occurs much earlier than the creatinine can detect. I'm not going to talk about the new markers, but I'll mention them. But basically what happens is that in order for the creatinine to go up, you need to damage about 50% of your kidneys. If you are normal, you usually have about 2 million nephrons, 1 million in each kidney. So in order for you to have just a simple rise in creatinine, you need to lose about 1 million. Unlike what happens in the heart, whenever you injure the heart, the enzymes go up. The kidney takes long to make that noise. And there are new markers that have been used to detect the kidney injury early. So when you are approaching a patient with acute kidney injury, the conventional way is to always establish where is the problem. So the problem of the acute kidney injury might be before the kidney. That is called pre-renal injury. It could be within the kidney, or it could be after the kidney, which is post-renal. So in that classification, you are not likely to miss a lot of things. The next slide is quite busy, but for the postgraduates, this is actually the slide that you need to master. For pre-renal injury, basically it's everything that comes before the kidney, and I think most of our patients had part of this. You have hypovolemia, this might be coming from diarrhea, vomiting, with everything else. You can have decreased cardiac output. You can have decreased effective circulating volume, like basically what happens with the Dr. Pio's issues when you have hepatorenal syndrome, and you know you have the effective circulating volume actually decreasing, whereas the kidney is still well, but it's not seeing any blood. And of course, you could also have just impaired renal autoregulation, especially when you use drugs like NSAIDs. You know the kidney always balances using its afferent and efferent in order for it to increase the intraglomerular pressure. And so when you interfere with that RAS, renin aldosterone angiotensin system, then you disturb the kidney and cannot moderate anymore. These drugs like the NSAIDs, the SE inhibitors, and drugs like cyclosporine have a tendency to do that. So I know we might not have enough time. So when you have such drugs, if the patient has been on them and they are getting AKI, it will be important to stop them. So that is the pre-renal. I'll talk about the clinical presence. So if someone has pre-renal, you are going to see their BPs are going to drop. You are going to take a good history. Probably they got involved in an accident. They have bled 2 liters. They have a fracture of the femur. You think they've lost about 2 liters. Or they have been unwell. They've been in ICU and you haven't been looking at their food. So they usually have hypovolemia to some extent, except when they have heart failure, like what you saw in the patient. He presented, he had a BP of 150 over 90. You have to think twice as you diagnose sepsis there. Of course, it usually begins up, but it will probably not be your first diagnosis, and particularly if you found basal crepitations and all these other things. So of course there I was with the doctor, I was feeling for him as Dr. Ayoko was now getting him. Of course the patient got ATN, but this patient was also probably fluid overloaded. So it becomes a very difficult case. I don't know whether he gave the Lasix to treat the heart failure, but it did not tell us the features of heart failure. said the guy had a tender hepatomegaly, but the liver was too tender, he could not elicit the hepatojugular reflex. So it was quite difficult. Maybe an echo or something to show whether the patient was in failure, or even as Arthur is going to tell you, doing an IVJ and looking at the volume status would have been important in that patient. But it was quite a tricky patient with quite high BPs, but clearly he had ATN, and probably in that case, the Lasix was not indicated. So we move to the intrinsic. So when you look at the intrinsic, you always look at the kidney. The kidney has a glomerulus, it has a tubules, and then it has the interstitium. So that's where the injury occurs in the kidneys. If you are looking at the glomerulus, this is mainly acute glomerulonephritis. I think the pediatricians are going to talk a lot about that, unless they are talking about malaria itself, but if they are talking about the typical ones, they will do that. There are many AGNs, I won't talk about that. And then you can have the tubules involved. When you have the tubules involved, there are actually about three. You have ischemia, and you have then sepsis or infection. But then what is increasingly not recognized is actually the nephrotoxicity. We get a lot of trouble here, especially with the use of contrast, drugs like aminoglycosides, amphotericin B, and the others we've talked about. Things like multiple myeloma also follow here. And then you could injure also the vascular itself. This basically involves vasculitis. For instance, when you have the PAKI associated syndromes, most of those that actually affect the vasculature, or you just have high blood pressure, which is malignant hypertension, and then the DTP, HUS. So these are important things because they involve the vasculature. So you probably need to do a peripheral film to look at that, because most of these patients would present with schistocytes in the peripheral film. You are going to find that they might have jaundice because they have hyperbilirubinemia. And then you are going to find, if you're able to do testing, that the haptoglobulins are going to be lower. And as Dr. Yop was saying, some of these people are also going to have hyperbilirubinemia, causing direct injury to the tubules of the kidney. So you really have to think about this. You have to do a fundoscopy to look at these patients. And then for TTP, HUS, you always look at the LDH. Okay? I don't know how I'm doing on time, but I've taken long without talking to physicians and medicine guys. So you, for TTP, HUS, you look at the LDH. Of course, if it's DIC, you are going to have some differential diagnosis. You've got to look at the DIC, ITP, rule out other things, look at the mentation of the patient, the kidney would be involved, so that will help you to differentiate. But by and large, it's important to diagnose TTPHUS because we can now do plasmapheresis. If you don't do plasmapheresis, the mortality is almost 100%. We've saved a few people. In fact, in Nagasero, we now have a case of HUS, and we've actually found out that it's actually a typical HUS, which you just read in textbooks. We did the complement and we found that they were reduced after going through everything. And this person seemed to have had HUS. So of course, the other one is the postrenal, which you should never miss. Once someone is anuric and they come to you, you always have to make sure they are not in obstruction. Very few things give you total anuria. Maybe bilateral venous thrombosis could give you anuria, but very few things do that. So what do we do? We really have to be observant and assess these patients closely by looking out for early warning signs and then basically responding accordingly and doing the right measurements. So for clinical assessment, you really have to assess the fluid status. Since Arthur is going to probably do management, the fluid status assessment can be very difficult. But you have to look at your patient, depending, the kids, I think it's easier, you know, they have a dry mouth, skin, what. For adults, it gets more complicated. But the key things to look at is one, the blood pressure. You look at the blood pressure and you actually look at the posture drop, if they have it, okay? You could also look at the JVP. If the JVP is raised, then you know that probably these people have fluid overload. And then the pulse, if someone is depleted, they usually have their pulse going up. But these are not specific. And then you look at the edema, the peripheral edema, unless they have other causes like hypothyroidism or they are malnourished, ideally the people should not have peripheral edema when they are dehydrated. But you have to put that into consideration. Then the passive leg raising test, which you can do. Some people do a 500 mil test, but that can be dangerous in a few instances, especially when people are overloaded. So you can do a passive leg raising test, which means that you tilt the patient to about 45 degrees, and then you see the increase in the pulse rate and the, basically the stroke volume, and you measure that. So that is, can be a good test. I have 5 minutes. So you also look for risk factors. I hope Bate will talk about those in children. I'm a physician, so I'll talk for those of adults. So if someone has any comorbidity disorder, diabetes, heart failure, if they have sepsis, low volume, they are older, they are using any of these drugs we've talked about, they have liver disease, those people, whenever they present to you, especially when they get admitted, they are at increased risk. So you approach the patient first, observing if they have any problems with the airway, the breathing, cardiovascular, and all those other things. And then you need to do some tests. Since today they were talking about urine, I'm going to try to move fast so that I don't miss the gist of the talk by talking about urine. So you have to assess the patient very fast, and not once. Every minute you keep coming back, or every 2 hours, you have to reassess the patient because the condition can change very fast. It's important to do tests. Creatinine is important. You need to do a urine assessment. And then, of course, calculation of the glomerular filtration rate, as I told you, might not be that important because it keeps changing and it's not useful in patients who are oliguric unless they are in a steady state. So we have used the fractional excretion of sodium, although that has also been questioned. Now, some studies have not demonstrated that it actually correlates with the output, but basically what you do, you take the creatinine and sodium in blood, and you also take the creatinine and sodium in urine, and then you see the fraction. If it is less than 1%, that is likely to be pre-renal, and then if it's more than 2, that is likely to be ATN. So that is one of the things we do, although here, when you ask for urinary electrolytes, people don't usually give them to you. They will actually ask you for 5 times the amount of money, yet they use the same measurements. I think they are just afraid of urine. But of course, that would be a good measure. I don't think you lose very much. What they traditionally use is the urea creatinine ratio. If the urea creatinine ratio is above 30, then you are more likely to think that this is pre-renal. But you have to convert the factor as well. It's milligram per milligram, not micromoles to the others. And so that's good to look at that. Then, of course, really, you can try to do fluid replacement. And if the person recovers within 24 hours and the urine begins to come, you know that they had AKI. So for the topic of the day, I thought I should talk about urine a little. I have 3 minutes, eh? About 3 minutes. So when you do urine, you can do a dipstick, and in the dipstick, you can look at the blood, you can look at the protein, you can look at the pH, you can look at leukocytes, nitrates, and glucose. So these are all important. Most of you have done your chemistry. So if you look at the blood, when you find blood, it means that this person either has real blood, which is red blood cells, or they have hemoglobin, or myoglobin, or any other compound. If it is protein, that problem is usually glomerular. So they have a glomerular problem, unless it's postural. And then when you look at the leukocytes, depending on their number, it's an infection. And nitrites also go towards an infection. Glucose should not be in urine unless it is raised in the bloodstream. But you should be aware of some syndromes like the Fanconi syndrome, where you have normal glycemic glycosuria or in the new drugs like Foxiga, which actually act by inhibiting the glucose transporters and therefore you spill glucose in urine. But for those who have HIV, you look at the TDF itself. Then you do microscopy. In microscopy, if you find red blood cell cast, that's GN. Of course, you have to look at, you have to spin the urine well. We now have a microscope in Chirudu. I hope you people are using it. A lot of diagnosis can be made from urine. Glomerulonephritis presents with hematuria and proteinuria. Pyelonephritis has a lot of leukocytes and nitrites. Interstitial nephritis, if you find eosinophilia, not commonly found, it's only found in about 15%, but once you find it, then you know that is likely to be interstitial. Oxalate crystals, this can be found in ethylene glycol poisoning. It's a very important way of diagnosing this. We had a case again in Nakasero where someone was sniffing glue and actually got ethylene glycol poisoning. Atha might have a lot to say about that. Then you can also use crystals in tumor lysis syndrome. And of course, when you have multiple myeloma, urine becomes important. And as you saw today in the presentation where Dr. Yoko was talking about the brown urine, which are the muddy brown casts that actually indicate you have ATN, acute tubular necrosis. You see the urine and it's muddy. You can use urine electrolytes. I talked about the FINA. You can also do uric acid, fractional excretion, or urea. But FINA has been used more. But the use of this is really in serial measurements. So what is the importance of urine in my last 01? Okay, 1 minute. You can see that the mortality here, people were actually questioning the Akin criteria and the rifle. They said maybe if you use the 0.5 mils per kilogram per hour, you are late. The right one should be 0.3 mils per kilogram per hour. And they went ahead to demonstrate. I know this might not be clear. Arthur, you had a pointer, but I think my 1 minute will be gone if people will trust me. Anyway, these are the mortality and the odds of dying or going to dialysis. Those red things you see. It's clear that the mortality goes up the less urine you produce. And this was further demonstrated even when they followed up these people for 1 year. So clearly the urine output can be a very good marker and even a prognostic marker. So when you have patients, if they are very sick, please ensure that you put in a catheter if it's not contraindicated and you measure the urine output. If you are with the Dr. Yoko and team, they will tell you to take daily weight. 1 kilogram is equal to 1 liter. So if you cannot take the urine, at least weigh the patient every day. But remember, that might be interfered with the food they eat, especially if you are giving them a lot. But by and large, that's how you monitor. So there are some other things that can be done. Please never forget the ultrasound scan. It helps you to rule out obstruction. And that's very important because that's an easy relief. The obstruction can be anywhere from the ureters up to the urethra. You can do a Doppler ultrasound if you think they have resistance or problems with the vessels. And there are these acute kidney injury markers. I've put it for the postgraduates because I'm sure Dr. Yoko would bring those in MCQs. And then you have the intra-abdominal blood pressure. Intra-abdominal pressures, you need to measure the bladder pressures, especially, I don't know whether Arthur will talk about that, but that's important. And then lastly, if you are unable to make any diagnosis and you see, for instance, if you have rapidly progressive GN, the creatinine is rising very fast and the patient has hematuria, you might actually pulse that patient, but you will also need to do a kidney biopsy to make the diagnosis. This is another slide for the postgraduates, which actually tells you what you need to do in every step. You begin with the simple things, but when things get difficult, we begin to do things like PIANCA, we do ANA, NA, anti-nuclear antibody. We can do the complement C3C4 helps you to know where you are falling. You can also do all these other tests. So that one, because of time, I won't go into it. So as I end my last slide, it's important when you think about acute kidney injury, it's important to know where you are. Staging it is important, and this is simple. You can use creatinine or use the urine output. That means you really need to measure the urine output. So you can think and use a synonym of stop. Usually sepsis is the commonest cause here. Toxicity from some of the drugs we use. Never forget to look at obstruction, because that's a low-hanging fruit. And then, of course, the parenchymal diseases, which you have to think about. When you are assessing the patient, at least always ensure that you look at the blood pressure, look at the postural drops, and then look at the urine output. You can assess other things. And then in the investigations, make sure at least you do the routine blood tests. I'm sure Arthur will talk about the ABGs, because they are very important. And as Dr. Yop was saying, you have to look at the indications for dialysis. You have to do the electrolytes, if hyperkalemia is intractable. You do the acid-base balance by taking the arterial blood. You have to look at volume overload. You probably need to look at the inferior vena cava. These days they use the ultrasound to be able to tell you the best fluid status. And once that is intractable, then you are able to intervene for the patient. So I thank you.